Do you know what the problem of the internet is? What I'm referring to is the so-called long-tail distribution of websites. There is a few websites attract the majority of users. So these are well-known websites like YouTube, Google, Facebook, Wikipedia. These are at the so-called tall head of the distribution. On the other end of the distribution, we have websites that attract only a small number of users each. So what we have is our users are on the tall head, end of the distribution, and our specialized content is on the other end. And that's the problem I want to address in this talk. It's the long user content distance. And what I ask myself and what I ask in this talk is, how can we bridge this content and why should we do so? And let me start with answering the question, why? And I would like to do this by an example. Imagine you're reading a Wikipedia page about Germany, and there the section about Germany's economy. And you stumble across the fact that Germany is the third largest exporter. Somehow you don't believe this. Maybe you are from Switzerland and you think we are exporting so much chocolate, we have to be the third largest exporter. So what would you do? Most probably, you would just use this hyperlink to investigate further. And this brings you to another Wikipedia page, which is called List of Countries by Export. And there, indeed, you find Germany listed on the third place. But the numbers you find there are from 2013 and are only estimates. So you still don't know whether the fact is still true. What if, at this point, we would have a resource handy from a trustworthy source, which would have newer numbers to validate the fact? And in fact, there is such a resource from EconBiz, in this case, from 2015, having the newer numbers. So why, or the answer to why we should aim to reduce the user content distance is because if we take those long-tail resources and set them into context with web pages, this would allow us to discover new information or to verify facts or even to enrich existing information. So we could, in this case, for instance, it would be to edit the Wikipedia page or update the Wikipedia page with the newer numbers. That was how why we should bridge this distance. And the second question is how this is currently done. And there are several strategies. From the content provider sides, there are either dedicated portals, most of them have them, and then they apply search engine optimization to get their resources and portals higher ranked on the major search engines. And also social network marketing is applied. What do users do? Users use major search engines, and major search engines are not optimized for this kind of content. They are optimized for mainstream content. If users knew of the dedicated portals, they would use them. And there's a third case where users don't know of the existence of resources and or these portals, in which case they would never find the content. So the current strategies can be summed up by that the user has to go and find the content, and so far the success is limited. So we had another brilliant idea, which is to upturn this process, and in order to reduce the user content distance, we bring the content to the users. And of course, we would like to do this in a helpful, polite, and non-obtrusive manner, so we don't want to spam, and we don't want to annoy the users. What would we need in order to achieve this goal? First, of course, we need to locate the users. So we need to identify the channels where the users are and provide technologies to inject or bring content into these channels. Okay, that's not enough. We also have to make sure that we inject the right content. So second, we need to find out what users need. And in order to do so, we need to detect the user context, use this context to provide personalized search results. And what is left to do is to present the resources pleasantly. And in this project, we use interactive visualizations to do so. What I'd like to do next is to go into more details into each of these building blocks. So in order to locate the users, we need to identify the channels where users frequently are. And we are in the course of this project, four categories of channels are of importance. First are social media channels, like Twitter, for instance. Secondly, content management systems are of special interest because if we were able to inject content into or present content while somebody is writing a blog and this person includes the content into the blog post, we would also reach all the users, all the readers of the blog post. So content management systems have a multiplier effect. There are more recent technologies like online word processors like Google Docs, for instance, which allow injection of third-party content as well. And of course, there are some channels where we don't have any access to, like YouTube, for instance. There we could rely on browser technology, browser extension plugin, to get the content to the users. As you see, there's a huge challenge in the variety of clients. So when deciding on which clients to focus first, it would be useful to favor clients with this multiplier effect I mentioned. I would now like to show you some example clients we developed. There is the WordPress plugin, where while writing a blog entry, you could cite a publication or include a link or include an image. Second, there is a browser extension which brings content to more explorative web search tasks. As an example for Wiki plugin, there's the EasyWiki plugin, which uses almost all the code that was written for the browser extension. And we have a Twitter bot and a Google Docs plugin as well. And what we learned when implementing all those different clients is that it really pays off to have a highly modular architecture. Not only a well-separated back-end and front-end, but also a very highly modular client architecture. Because most of the clients use standard web technologies, JavaScript, HTML, CSS. So if you have a well-separated structure within the client, you can reuse the code heavily. So now we know how to get content to the users. What is still missing is which content to get there. So we need to find, or in order to find out what the users need, we need to detect their current context and translate this user context into some representation of an information need. And I would like to show you, as an example, the browser extension. So there might be an information need, or you would like, there might be an information need on different levels of granularity. For instance, you might need resources for a whole page, which is topically rather broad. You might also need resources for a certain paragraph only, or even for a part of a paragraph, in this case, a selection. When we have the context, this user context is sent to a search backend, and then personalized results are returned and displayed. And I would like to give you more details on this, how we infer the user's information need for a selection, so for number 3 in this case. If we had a user selection and the according query, which led to good results for most users, we could train an automatic model to learn this mapping from text selection to query. Such a data set does not exist for this specialized content, so we created one ourselves. Let me show you this by an example. There is a paragraph about from the Encyclopedia Britannica about the French Revolution. And we ask users to find portions of the text, it need not be a sentence, could be any portion of the text, where they would like to have additional resources. This is, in this case, the yellow highlight. And then we ask them to generate a query which gives them good results for the resources they would want for further explanation. So we have this mapping between the yellow highlight and the good query. We use this data set to train a conditional random field. And no worry, I don't want to go into the details here. I just want to give you the most interesting result. That's exactly here. So what we found out, we can predict a good user query, a query where users had retrieved good results from a text selection with approximately 90% accuracy. What we learned when doing this experiment, in order to do this experiment, that it is important to collect ground truth data as early as possible, especially if there is no data set available where we can train our methods. And we learned a second lesson, that it's important to collect ground truth data as early as possible. From other experiments that are so far more qualitatively, it seems to be that the information need of a user is entity-based. So what does that mean? Let me again use an example. In this case, the Wikipedia page about the Pareto principle. It seems to be that the information need of a user can be represented by the entities that are present in this paragraph, or in this paragraph here. So what we did, we extracted the entities. In this case, these are the green ones. The entities extracted were, for instance, Wilfredo Pareto 4 times, Italy Pareto principle. And then we also extracted more abstract concepts from the paragraph, like the red terms in this case, tails of probability distribution or power law. The insight that information need seems to be entity-based is so far only qualitative confirmed, and we are planning to do a quantitative experiment in the future. So now we are at the point where we can inject content to where the users are. We can identify the right content, and what is left to do is to present the results pleasantly. And we use visualizations for 2 reasons. First, our main target group are general public users, and they want engaging user interfaces. And secondly, visualizations help to deal with the information overload because they use the power of the human visual system, which uses heavily parallel processing compared to, for instance, the part of the brain which is responsible for speech recognition. You tried this yourself in the morning in Eric Tsui's talk about, can you remember the galaxy images? This was heavily parallel processing in the brain. In the project, we devised two different types of visualizations. And the first one doesn't care or doesn't need to know anything about the data types in the result set. It just reads every metadata dimension or every data dimension as text. This makes it rather flexible. However, text might not need to be the best representation for each data type. So let me give you one example. This is a visualization for faceted browsing, where each metadata facet, in this case year, language, provider, license, and type, is represented as an area. And all the values in the result set for this facet are arranged in a tag cloud manner. This visualization is interactive, so it allows you to select different facet values and thereby filter the result set interactively. So as you see, text seems not, or treating metadata dimension as pure text seems to be not the most perfect solution for some of this data. For instance, for the year facet, it would be more appropriate to use a time-like representation. This brings me to the second type of visualizations, which are tied to a specific metadata type, And I would like to show you an example, which is the geographical visualization, which gives you an instant overview of the distribution, of the geographic distribution of resources in the result set. And again, this visualization is interactive, so with a quick selection, you could filter the result set. What we learned when designing and implementing the visualization was that it is important, or it is helpful, to have mock-up data. So especially the second visualization was developed and tested using fake data only. There were two reasons. For one, or the first reason is that geo information might not be available at an early stage from the backend modules. And the second, the more important reason is that using fake data, so perfect data, you avoid talking about data quality or result quality if you want to talk about visualizations. So what happened often in other visualizations is that we showed the user interface and the discussion only went about, I didn't expect this one to pop up. And what we wanted to talk about is whether this visualization was usable or not. So fake data avoids discussion about other back-end modules. Let me give you a brief summary. The aim was to reduce this user content distance by bringing the content to the user. And the highly modularized EXS framework allows to inject content in different channels. Remember the WordPress plugin? Detects the information need to present personalized results and presents them in a pleasant way. And what do we gain in doing so? It enables the discovery of new information as well as enrichment and verification of existing information. I started this talk with a question, and I would like to end this talk with a question. Do we have any questions? think it doesn't work, this one.
Thanks. So you did mention that a certain way of presenting data visually as an extension of online tools or social media tools can be very fruitful for working with this kind of information, for example, in Wikipedia. However, we have seen a few surveys here on that conference that researchers are not so much using this kind of technology or platforms actively. Only a few of us do so, perhaps some more of those who are participating in the conference, but not so many of our colleagues who are not here. And my question is, to what extent are the scientists indeed aware of the general usefulness of tools like Wikipedia or Mendeley or others, or you, what you did show here? Is it really meeting the demands or the needs of an average researcher what you have introduced?
First of all, scientists are not the main target group of this project, and as to why or whether scientists are aware of Mendeley and the other social media channels, was that the question?
Yes. So my critique is, or my concern is, yeah, that scientists are perhaps using those platforms for reading, but not for presenting themselves or for contributing actively. This is just a minority of the scientists, yeah, who write definitely on Wikipedia.
Yeah.
But if you clarify that with, it's the, just for another audience.
The main focus group is generic public users and citizen scientists, more, if we talk in these terms, but not the scientists, okay, mainly.